A rough week for the banking industry.
The collapse of Silicon Valley Bank.
The second biggest bank collapse in U.S. history.
Our banking system is in a fundamentally different place than it was, you know, a decade ago.
And the economists are now asking if Fed will hit pause on further rate increases.
It's been just over 6 months since the Silicon Valley Bank collapse, and the perpetual doomsday scenario in the U.S. financial system looms on the horizon. It leaves many investors wondering, where is this crisis? Or perhaps we are merely in the eye of the storm, and this calm is only temporary. Today we're talking about the banking crisis 3.0 and why this looks eerily similar to 2008. Firstly, both the Federal Reserve and the Treasury have made it abundantly clear, not merely in words but in their actions, that they are committed to safeguarding their own. On the flip side, the escalating interest rates bring with them the specter of a potential recession, corporate defaults, and bankruptcies. Should we be concerned? The credit rating agencies were poised to enter the fray, and lo and behold, they have begun revising their credit assessments right on schedule. According to Barclays PLC, in the United States, approximately $11.4 billion worth of bonds were downgraded to high yield status in the first quarter. There is a substantial likelihood that this number could surge to around $80 billion, equating to about 2.2% of BBB corporate bonds by the conclusion of 2023. To put it mildly, the outlook is far from optimistic. A further decline in deposit numbers is expected to lead to an uptick in interest rates on deposits offered by financial institutions, even if the Fed eases up on tightening monetary policy. Consequently, the net interest margin on bank deposits is likely to decrease over time. Given the need to mitigate losses and minimize risks, banks are likely to persist in tightening lending criteria. The predicament lies in the fact that in most U.S. counties, small and medium-sized financial institutions account for a significant 90% of loans to small businesses. We see this financial crisis like steering a container ship into an iceberg. In the beginning, when you're far enough, you can change course and avoid trouble. But if you stay on the same course, you won't be able to avoid a crisis later, as it's too late to change an economy with the size and momentum of the U.S. In the broader context, a small cluster of banks, whose depositors had significant correlations, experienced a relatively minor episode of a bank run. To elaborate, Silicon Valley Bank primarily served startups, but their deposit growth slowed down as startup funding decreased. Many of their customers were depleting their deposits. Consequently, a wave of panic ensued, leading to approximately 25% of all deposits being withdrawn from the bank in a single day. The other two banks were heavily intertwined with the crypto industry, with crypto exchanges holding their funds in these banks. As people began withdrawing funds from cryptocurrencies, these banks experienced a rapid depletion of their cash reserves. It's worth noting that Credit Suisse has humorously been referred to as Debit Suisse for an extended period. When the FDIC assumed control of collapsing Silicon Valley Bank, they embarked on a weekend endeavor to sell the bank's assets. However, they were cautious about allowing banks capable of absorbing these assets without destabilizing themselves to bid on them. This approach aimed to prevent further concentration in the sector. There are two ways to inadvertently facilitate the expansion of giant banks. One approach is to permit them to acquire failing medium-sized banks, and the other is to refrain from allowing them to do so. In times of depositor panic seeking safety, they tend to flock to large institutions like JP Morgan, Bank of America, and UBS. The acquisition of Silicon Valley Bank by First Citizens Bank could signal a turning point in the banking crisis. This marks the first instance of a bank acquisition following a failure since the 2008 financial crisis. It underscores the government's commitment to taking necessary actions to safeguard the financial system, potentially contributing to its stability. Under the agreement's terms, First Citizens Bank acquired Silicon Valley Bank's assets, totaling $110 billion, comprising $56 billion in deposits and $72 billion in loans. This acquisition comes at a discounted price of $16.5 billion. First Citizens Bank will not make an upfront cash payment for the deal. Instead, it has granted equity appreciation rights in its stock to the FDIC, which could have a value of up to $500 million. The FDIC will provide support for the transaction, estimating that it will cost its FDIC insurance fund approximately $20 billion due to Silicon Valley Bank's failure, At the close of 2022, First Citizens Bank was roughly half the size of Silicon Valley Bank. Following the acquisition, First Citizens will become slightly larger than Silicon Valley Bank was before its collapse, boasting an estimated $219 billion in assets. This deal allows First Citizens to expand its footprint in California and gain wealth management capabilities in the northeastern United States. The 17 former Silicon Valley Bank branches will reopen as First Citizens branches. The announcement of the Silicon Valley Bank deal has propelled First Citizens Bank shares stock to a record high with a 49% increase. Meanwhile, First Republic Bank stock surged by 23% following a $30 billion rescue package from 11 of the largest banks. The government has granted approval for First Citizens Bank to acquire the failed bank Silicon Valley Bank. The deal will not involve an upfront cash payment by First Citizens Bank, but will instead grant equity appreciation rights in its stock to the FDIC, potentially worth up to $500 million. The FDIC will backstop the transaction with an estimated cost of about $20 billion to its FDIC insurance fund. This agreement follows the transfer of all SVB deposits and assets into a new bridge bank, earlier in an effort to protect depositors of the failed institution. The First Citizens Bank and Trust Company is a subsidiary of First Citizens Bank shares. First Citizens already owns CIT, a middle market finance company, and Equipment Lessor, which it acquired out of bankruptcy after the 2008 financial crisis. With the acquisition of the SVB portfolio, FCNCA is taking on additional underperforming credits, including startup financing and troubled commercial real estate loans. It appears that the SVB book of business was so undesirable that the FDIC had to accept terms of no cash, no equity, and only future option appreciation to facilitate the acquisition. This bank may pose significant risks in a recession, and even creative accounting may not rescue it. First Citizens and the FDIC have also engaged in a loss share transaction, where the FDIC assumes a portion of the losses on a specific pool of assets, specifically the commercial loans acquired from the SVB Bridge Bank. The loss share transaction is designed to optimize asset recoveries by keeping them within the private sector, with the additional benefit of minimizing disruptions for loan customers, clarified the FDIC. The regulator further noted that the estimated cost of SVB's failure to its deposit insurance fund is expected to be approximately $20 billion, with the precise amount to be determined upon the termination of the receivership. The bank's collapse ensued after a substantial withdrawal of funds by its clients, amounting to billions, and a significant devaluation of assets previously considered secure, such as U.S. Treasury bills and government-backed mortgage securities, due to the Federal Reserve's aggressive interest rate hikes. This left the bank in a precarious position as it sought to raise $2.25 billion to fulfill client withdrawal demands and support new lending initiatives. As of March 10th, the SVB Bridge Bank reported approximately $167 billion in total assets and approximately $119 billion in total deposits, as confirmed by the FDIC. SVB's collapse reverberated across global banks and was identified as one of the triggers for the eventual downfall of Swiss banking giant Credit Suisse, which required an emergency rescue from its domestic counterpart, UBS. Analysts believe that it's still an opportune time to invest in First Citizens, even considering the recent increase in its stock price. Essentially, they acquired $16.5 billion in tangible net equity at no cost. The deal is structured with safeguards provided by the FDIC over a 7-year period, and the FDIC is also addressing the funding gap for the loan book. This acquisition is projected to be independently beneficial to CET1 Capital, and it significantly expanded First Citizens' lending portfolio, likely resulting in increased earnings. In essence, First Citizens has effectively doubled in size while generating income from this expansion. We anticipate that the company's stock will experience substantial growth from this point onward. The impact of these events extended to Europe as well, resulting in Credit Suisse being compelled to undergo a takeover by Swiss competitor UBS earlier this month due to a significant decline in its share price. Experts have stated that social media plays a huge role in the spread of such news. Jonathan Yerushalmi, The Guardian's correspondent, mentioned the SVB fiasco as follows. The first Twitter-fueled bank run, how social media compounded SVB's collapse. The Silicon Valley Bank faced its demise as depositors hurried to withdraw funds due to concerns about the bank's stability. This marked the second largest bank collapse in U.S. history, following the 2008 failure of Washington Mutual. An argument can be made that occasional bank failures can be beneficial. The longest period in U.S. history without a bank failure occurred from 2004 to 2007, and the subsequent events are well known. While the overall banking industry is likely resilient, it's worth noting that SVB might have weathered the storm had there not been a simultaneous panic withdrawal. Nonetheless, SVB's collapse isn't ideal, especially for those left dealing with the aftermath. Concerns persist regarding the overall health of the banking system. Alexander Yoakum, an analyst at CFRA Research who covers banking, pointed out that there might be more challenges ahead as the Federal Reserve continues to raise interest rates, especially if done aggressively, in an effort to curb inflation and cool down the economy. The higher rates go, the more problematic it becomes for banks on the brink, Yoakum cautioned. Many analysts contend that the ensuing market volatility has been disproportionate, given the idiosyncratic weaknesses that left SVB and Credit Suisse vulnerable and eroded investor confidence. In summary, despite regulatory backing, the ongoing surge in interest rates is poised to put the brakes on the U.S. economy. Sooner or later, the growing problems will become apparent, prompting the disposal of risky assets. As a result, the process of financial institutions either faltering or attempting to recoup funds from U.S. bank accounts appears highly probable. Thank you for joining us on this insightful journey. Like and subscribe for timely updates in the world of economy.